Hello, Malty, ministriously memorable moonshiners. Thank you, Pulsar L2C, for that malt mention, introducing Ralfy Review 833X. And to be honest, I couldn't make out even what I was reading there for that malt mention. Ministriously memo cable. It's a sign of the times. Weird malt mentions. Anyway, welcome, malt mates, to Ralfy Review 833 Extras. Extras. You know, some of you are actually preferring the extras to the actual whisky reviews. Because when you're reviewing a whisky, you're giving a very specific perspective on a very specific malt, and it can only ever be your own view and opinion. And our tastes vary, our experience varies, our aspirations and our adventurousness varies. So it can only ever be an opinion, even if it's in a book, even if it's in a distillery, even if it's from someone who's really, really prominent in the scene, or if it's someone who you just happen to bump into in a bar. You can only get opinions about the smell and taste of whiskey or any other spirit in the world, anywhere, ever, because it's subjective. And technically, when any distiller is producing liquor, all they really have to do is produce something of competent enough quality, which will be exactly the measure in the bottle as stated in the label, which is exactly the percent alcohol in the bottle as stated in the label, and is, if there is an age statement, that the age statement is honest and accurate and represents the youngest component in the mix if it's Scotch whisky. And there's various regulations around the world, and bourbon has pretty good regulations and tends to be more consistent as a product because they're using virgin oak prepared casks, which through an accident of history has proven to be very successful for the bourbon industry. So they have this continuity, that consistency, which at times Scotch whisky struggles to maintain because of supply and demand and the politics of sourcing casks. That's what it's all about. And often when we're looking for information, we can start to look, say if you buy a bottle of, say, Tobermory, and you don't know much about it. So what's the first thing you do? You go online, you open up a new page in your search engine and you type in Tobermory, and if you're lucky, it should take you to the distillery website, which will have some nice pictures, and it will check your age before you enter the site to make sure you're of legal drinking age where you are and all the usual stuff. And you'll get something which is a fairly tasteful and not too over the top sales site. But when you look further down, you might find additional information regarding a specific distillery, and it could be a Scotch distillery, a rum distillery, a bourbon distillery, and some of them have really, really interesting histories, and that includes Tobermory. So I'm going to tell you a bit about the history of Tobermory, or Isle of Mull Distillery. And I have to say, when I'm over in Scotland, when I'm across the Irish Sea, because it's usually quite choppy, that's why I'm doing the big wave movement. It's the way it is. It's quite a shallow sea, you see, so it kind of reacts more to weather patterns. But I like going to Scotland. I like to visit a distillery for no other reason than just to get the feel of being there. And I know that many of you whisky fans, when you visit Scotland, you want to go and visit a distillery where you can get a really, really good access. In other words, where you visit is going to be the real deal. And I find that although there are quite a number of modern distilleries now, and they're very professional with their presentations. They just don't have the feel of the old buildings and the old distilleries. The old distilleries are, they are haunted by the ghosts of their past. There's a spirit apart from the whiskey. Yeah, that's a good way of putting it, actually. With old distilleries, with their stone walls and pagoded slated roofs and their century rows of warehouses, all nice and compact and neat and somewhere out remote, there's something very romantic about it in the fullest sense. And you get so much more out of drinking the liquor when you're actually on location in the presence, in the zone, in the feng shui of that distillery. And one of these distilleries you'll find that out is at the Isle of Mull Distillery in Tobermory. It has a very tempestuous history. It goes right back to, it was founded really even while the Napoleonic Wars were raging across Europe. And it was all about the money, because it's all about the money. That's what it is. When you understand what money really is, then you understand so, so much more than you did before. It changes everything, your whole perspective, even affect influencing your life significantly when you really know what money truly is all about. And the Napoleonic Wars were blazing away, and there was an awful lot of illegal distilleries, which they weren't, they're called illegal now, they weren't called illegal then. It's just the labelling that we put on the old days from the days in which we're living. They were legitimate businesses which were called illegal because after the Napoleonic Wars and the poverty that wars cause, the first thing that people in power do is that they raid their population for the wealth to pay for the wars. Because, you know, you can take out loans for wars from banks. Did you know that? There you go. You didn't think that it was that cynical, but hey, it's real life. So the Bank of England at that point, at the end of Waterloo, is the stage where the Rothschilds really took control of it. And very professional people. Money was their business and it's something they were really, really good at. And they organised the reboot of the tax raising system. And of course, the best thing to tax the most heavily are these items that the population need the most. So for example, malted barley, which was used for beer and whiskey and other spirits, and salt, essential for preservation and for flavour in an age when there was very few herbs and spices around apart from the smart people that grew them in the garden. And only the rich could afford pepper. And clove, oh my goodness, cloves and nutmegs. Nutmegs were worth more than gold. How times have changed. So you've got this historical situation that there's a set of circumstances come together and then something happens. And what happens is, what's happening right now? Right now, a bottle of whiskey becomes a legitimate form of investment currency. This is why so many people are collecting, because it's a way, like Swiss watches or old perfumes or handbags or fashion items or whatever, take your pick. It becomes a form of mutually recognised exchangeable currency of value. And it was just the same in the 18th century when the Isle of Mull distillery was built by a man who wanted to have a bigger business because he was fed up doing it out the back of a barn. Now, initially the landowner was, you know, you can have a brewery, but you mustn't have a distillery because there's already two distilleries which were in operation. But he persevered and he pushed ahead, and Tobermory was founded in, here's my date, 1798. Now, it wasn't until 1823 that the Excise Act came in. and license were being granted by the aristocracy to get distilleries, legitimate distilleries, built on their land where they could get the revenue from renting out the business. It's all about the money. But meanwhile, way, way before the others, before Glenlivet, before Glencadam, before Northport, you know, the really old distillery, before Macallan, you had Lechaic Distillery on the Isle of Mull. And the reason was simple. The islands were more isolated and they needed just any and every opportunity they could get. And they were looking south at Isla and all the illegal distillation, the hooching that was going on there and the demand for that hooch because it was so full of flavour. And it was currency and it could be exchanged. A bottle of Usca Bay, Aquavit, could be exchanged and swapped, bartered. And the governments don't like bartering. They don't like swapsies because how the hell do they tax it? They need to have coinage used as the medium of exchange so that they can get, so they can withdraw the wealth that's being generated in society and give it to the banks so it can be centralised. So you've got Lechaic looking south at Isla and all these, you know, looking at these heavily peated whiskies, and they're saying to themselves, oh my goodness, we're missing out in the action here. Because the way you measured the value of liquor currency was you'd smell it, you'd taste it, you'd have a chat about it, you'd have a wee social, amicable social about it, and then basically, well, that smells really good, that tastes really good. I think it's worth 5 cabbages or 10 potatoes instead of 2 or 3. It's the way it worked in these days. Tobermory Distillery, Isle of Mull Distillery, it's had a very checkered past. It's been closed and shut down, mothballed over the last, 300 years? Let me see, 1790, we'll call it 1890, 200 years, 200 odd years. It's been closed almost as often as it's been open producing, for the simple reason that any distillery that was on an island rather than on the mainland had greater difficulties with transportation and therefore greater costs of transportation. But of course the West Coast fishermen, if they weren't fishing, if it was out of season or wherever, they could diversify and they just, any boat would do to take the few, transport the whiskey, and of course they had to transport it in something. So they'd get the local landowner to roll out a few barrels. And of course, barrels that were used for fish were no use for whiskey because it was just dreadful with the result. But with the landowners buying their claret and their brandy and their port by the barrel, as soon as they'd emptied the barrel, they could fill it with the liquor. And of course, they'd get a few bottles as a thank you for the favour. And of course, the whiskey's being transported over water in these barrels that used to hold claret or port or rum or sherry, Madeira. And of course, once they reached the shops, the licensed grocers who were selling it, they'd say, well, hang about, you know, this has been sitting in the quayside for about the last month or two. It tastes better than the clear stuff. People are now asking us for this Usca Bay with a bit of colour in it, a bit of cask, a little bit of wood in it, because it smells better and tastes better. And any liquor that smells better and tastes better commands a higher price. So the licensed grocers who were selling it by the flagon, you know, that people say, oh, you've got it from that island distillery. And I see there's been a storm recently, so it's been sitting in the dockside because they couldn't transport it over. Oh, we'll have some of that. You know, this, when you're visiting old distilleries, you get to know these stories. You can feel it in the stonework and the bricks and the mortar and the fact that so little has changed. And it is such a powerful, powerful advantage to spontaneous, natural connection. It's not marketing. It's just connection. It's something malt makes that you and I are valuing more and more, whichever distillery we visit. We want some connection. We want to connect to the place through the bottle. And we also want to connect to the place to understand the bottle better. So we connect to the bottle to find the distillery, and we connect to the distillery to find the bottles. This is one reason why distillery-only bottlings are so, so important wherever your distillery is. It's not about talking the history, it's about presenting the history, just showing the old stuff, not throwing anything out. You never, ever, ever throw out an old set of Cooper's tools, because they're irreplaceable. I'll show you some Cooper's tools. I've got them here for a wee thing I'm doing in my Patreon chat channel. This is a driver. Look at that. Isn't that a thing of beauty? Do you know what? The Cooper who used this has used it for decades. He's put some red tape around it. You see the red tape? So that when he dropped it in the floor, in the poor lighting, he could pick up, because he'd see where it is. And he'd tell the other Coopers, don't you touch my tools. I've got red tape on them. They're my tools. Because over time, every Cooper's tool would carry the signature of their activity. And here's a £2 £2 hammer, driver hammer. They go around the casks using incredible technique. It looks straightforward. It's a wooden container with steel hoops around it. You know, it's a simple device, but see the skill of getting it right. Watching a Cooper in a distillery, you will learn more in 5 minutes watching a Cooper create and service and condition a cask than you will listening 2 hours to a brand ambassador. It's true. We're very lucky in Scotland. We've got these old distilleries. And in the US, it's one of the things when building a new bourbon distillery or a multi-spirits distillery is taking the opportunity to keep control of your funds and investing as much in the substance of your operation as you can. You know, you cannot start up a distillery on the cheap. It just doesn't work, because you'll just be viewed as a cheap option. The infrastructure, the physical stonework, the quality of the wood involved, this is all so, so, so important. And this is why if you visit a distillery which is just in a prefabricated industrial unit, you enjoy the experience, but it's just not the same as when you go to something more historical, more substantial, which has got the weight of history behind it, which fires our imagination, which triggers our senses to connect on a deeper level with the product that's being produced. And it's the way it is. Isle of Mull Distillery, it doesn't get visited so often, but when you do, you can be rest assured you're not going to be with crowds and crowds of folk who are kind of doing the distillery trail, because it's off the distillery trail. It's one of these quieter distilleries, and it's got a fascinating history. It's ups and downs, it's triumphs and it's crisis. And at the moment, I think it's lovely to be reviewing not just this, but my next review is going to be Lechake, 18-year-old. It's a lovely, heavily peated whiskey. And it's lovely to see a distillery which had its low points. And I remember when it's not that long ago when the bottlings were just the most boring bottlings you'd see in the shelves of shops. And they were so dull and simple and featureless that you just didn't buy them, even though they were cheaper. And when you did, the flavour was just, it wasn't much. But you can see now with more a modern contemporary reinvestment in something which has stood the test of time. And they're rediscovering the fabulous flavours and personality and identity. You know, this would do so well in a Sauternes cask. This will mature so well in wine casks. Be interesting to see what happens or in our sweet wine casks and white port casks. Oh my goodness, tawny port. Oh, fino sherry. Anyway, what do I know? I hope you enjoy. I just took the opportunity here, by the way. It's just a bit of a ramble. What triggered it off was actually that I'm writing my second book at the moment, Malt Mates. But I'll tell you more about that later. And I was doing research and I just tripped over this. And there you have it. Bye. I'll speak to you soon for Ralfy Review 834, which will be around along in a week's time. Switch off the old-fashioned way, because it works.